Good morning, everyone. Happy to have everyone here this morning. The festival's a wonderful time for us, but it really kills us on attendance here on those two Sundays. Always the fewest two Sundays we have every year. But if you're happy to be here this morning, how about a great big amen?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Start off with our announcements this morning. Do we have any announcements? I'll tell you what, I'm going to read what I've got first here, okay? We have on Tuesday at 6:30, we have Foundations of Faith class, men's Bible study also. On Wednesday, we have our Kids for Christ, and also that evening at 6:30, we have an ad council meeting and a trustee meeting. Thursday is Buddy Bags, if you'd like to help with that, and also celebrate recovery. And there's some other things here. If you would, just check your bulletin out down below. Go through and check everything. I'm going to go over to Pastor Brian right now. Brian, you have anything for us this morning?
One thing that I wanted to highlight is actually the last thing on the announcements list is that All Saints Sunday is coming up on November 1st, and there's an extra little insert in your bulletin. So All Saints Day is when we as a church, not just our local church, but actually most churches all around the world, will celebrate the saints that have gone before us, and particularly the saints from our own church family that have passed on in the last year, and we celebrate their life. So it's really easy for me to know and to track those who are our members that have gone to be with the Lord in the past year. But if you want friends and family to be remembered as well, it's helpful if you would fill that out with their name and a little bit other information so that we can make sure that we're honoring those people as well on that day.
Thank you, Pastor Brian. Anybody else have any announcements this morning? Over there, Maddie. We'll let her go, guys. She's got
okay.
Younger legs.
Yeah. I just wanted to thank everybody for all of your help for the yard sale. We did break our record. Our record last year at the rummage sale, we sold $1,100, and this year we did $1,544.
There we go.
So thanks a lot for that. If anybody wants to take home any freebies before I pack it up, we're not going to open. We're only going to do hospitality for the public today. So if anybody wants anything out of the back, just you're welcome to it.
Okay. Thank you, Randy. Anybody else have anything this morning? Any announcements? Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries this week? No? Okay. If you would, let us stand for our call to worship this morning. In covenant with God and each other, we affirm our unity in Christ.
We will take faithful steps to live as a worldwide church in mission for the transformation of the world.
In covenant with God and each other, we commit ourselves to be in ministry with all people.
In faithfulness to the gospel, we will cross boundaries of language, culture, social, or economic status as we grow in mutual love and trust.
In covenant with God and each other, we participate in God's mission as partners in ministry.
We share our God-given gifts, experiences, and resources, recognizing that they are of equal value, whether spiritual, financial, or missional.
In covenant with God and each other, we commit ourselves to full equality.
We uphold equity and accountability in our relationships, structures, and responsibilities for the denomination.
In covenant with God and each other, we enter afresh into a relationship of mutuality. Excuse me.
We joyfully live out our worldwide convention in mission for the transformation of the world.
And if praise team could come forward. Oh, excuse me. Yes, praise team. Sorry.
Thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to Thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for Thy courts above.
This is an oldie but goodie.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from
If you would, let's follow along with our opening prayer this morning. Teach us, good Lord, to serve you as you deserve,
to give
and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek rest, to labor and not to ask for any reward, except that of knowing that we do your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And please be seated.
Do we have any kids?
Oh, we do.
We do.
Good morning. How are you this morning? You're smiling, so you must be good. You think?
Yeah.
Hey, what makes you happy? I want you to think about it just a minute. Tell me, what makes you happy? Maddie, I'm going to start with you. What makes you happy?
Jesus.
Sit right in here.
Jesus.
Great.
What makes you happy?
Jesus.
Jesus.
What makes you happy?
You don't have to talk into it. What makes you happy, Chelsea? Does Grandma and Grandpa help make you happy?
Yeah, Grandma and Grandpa make you happy, don't they? Well, I want to read something from the Bible that Pastor Brian's going to talk about today. Here's what I love about reading. If you watch TV or if you play a video game, it's all right there in front of you. But when you read a book, you can think about it in your head. And I love to imagine different pictures in my head. So, I want to read something from the Bible for you this morning. And hopefully I won't lose my place today. I did the last time. It says, remember we're talking about Nehemiah and that big wall he built? Remember that big wall he built around Jerusalem? Well, it's all finished. And they're going to have a big party. So listen to this. At the dedication or the party of the wall of Jerusalem, the Levites were sought out from where they lived and were brought to Jerusalem to celebrate joyfully. Remember that word joyfully. The dedication with songs of thanksgiving and with music of cymbals and harps and lyres. And the singers also were brought together from the region around Jerusalem, from the villages. Well, when you are happy, do you sing? Do you sing, Maddie, when you're happy?
Sometimes.
Isaac, do you sing when you're happy? I do. When I'm really happy, or sometimes in the morning, I'll play praise music, and that will make me joyful. When you are joyful in the Lord, it makes you really happy. So this morning, I have a song I want us to sing. Now, I'm sure Maddie knows it, and I'll bet you've heard your grandma sing this song. I have the joy, joy, joy down in my heart. Do you know that song? You don't know that song? You're going to know it now, because we're going to learn it. But I want the congregation to join me. And when I point to you, I want you to say, where? Okay, you ready? Okay, they're going to help us.
I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart. Got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart.
Oh, we gotta do that again. They missed the wares. Are you ready now? Okay, now I'm gonna ask Mr. Tony and Miss Jen and Mr. Jerry back here. They're gonna help us with the wares, okay? All right, here we go.
I've got the joy, 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 joy down. down in my heart.
Better. Well, I want you to think about being joyful in the Lord. When the wall was all finished, they had a big celebration with music and a band, and they were joyful. So think about being joyful today. You'll do that? Good for you. I know you will. Let's pray. Father God, we just come to you this morning with a joyful heart and a joyful attitude. And we ask that you just keep that joy going in our lives and in our hearts through this week. In Jesus' name, amen. This makes Mr. Milligan joyful. Do you know what it is? Chocolate. Somebody knows him. You can take two.
Just one.
It's okay. I told him to take two.
What is this called?
Those are good. They're crackles. They're my favorite. Okay. You can go with Mr. Tony.
What a blessing it is to have children in our church. Amen. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. One thing that's nice about having a smaller gathering this morning is I almost got around to everyone before we started, but I didn't get around to everyone. So for those I didn't say hello to yet this morning, Alex, Leanne and Luann. Who else did I miss? Mark and Linda. Tracy, I felt your tap on my shoulder. I counted that as our greeting. No, that's okay. I appreciated that you tapped me on the shoulder. Carol, Susan, and Miriam, Janie, Carol.
Good morning.
Good morning. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, today we are actually celebrating Laity Sunday, although sometimes it gets overtaken by Bridge Festival. And so you may see in some of our prayers and the things that we talk about this morning, we're talking about unity, we're talking about all of us using the gifts that God has given us, and we're talking about working together in one common mission of making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. So let's keep in mind our unity and our love for one another as we share praises and prayer requests. Does anyone have a praise or prayer request they'd like to share this morning? Carol?
I think we should continue to uphold Bob and Janie Pound in our prayers.
I think so too. Yeah. Janie is with us this morning. Bob is with us in spirit. And Janie, thank you for playing for us this morning. There are many others who need our prayers in our community for health, for grief, for tragedy. And Shannon?
Charlie just wanted me to mention that he's been sick since Wednesday. And he woke up this morning and said, I feel better today, but we go back to school tomorrow, so hopefully he'll be on his medicine and feel well. So he asked that you pray for him.
Okay, we'll pray for Charlie.
We have a joy. Wednesday when Sunday, he's at 2 o'clock, something isn't very
He's very good. And so I was going to the nursing home at Vermilion this week, and I said, would you go? I warned him, bring your shoes with you. And would you go with me and clog? And he said, sure. And we did. And I even got to tap dance while he was clogging, and it was wonderful. They loved it. And then Thursday, the three of us went to Chrisman, Illinois. And oh, they loved it. She's a wonderful piano player like Janie, and it has a beautiful voice. and I get to harmonize with her since I don't have a choir anymore. But we had a wonderful time. They loved it. They're such a great group. I mean, there's about 50 or 60 come out for entertainment. And so it was a really great week.
Thank you, Dorothy. Dorothy is one of those among us that has to share the joy of the Lord and the praises that she sees in her life, which I think is a spiritual gift. All right, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Father God, thank you for being with us in our community, and thank you for sustaining us through many trials, through many temptations, through great heartache, and through Bridgefest. God, thank you for always being present with us. Thank you for sending your Son to redeem us. Thank you for sending your Spirit to minister directly to our hearts so that we wouldn't have to wait once a year for priests to sacrifice on our behalf and to meet with you, but that we could have your grace available to us daily through your Spirit. What a wonderful gift. Yeah, we thank you for those in our community who you have healed in the past week, and we thank you also for those that need healing, and we pray that you would give that to them. And even though you sometimes work in mysterious ways and you do things that we don't understand, help us to be at peace, that you are in control, that you are all-powerful, but also that you are all-loving, that we know your character. And even in the midst of suffering and tragedy, we know that you are there, that you suffer with us, and that one day you will renew everything, all of creation. God, we pray especially for Bob that you would continue to heal him, and that he would be able to be back with us soon. And we thank you for Charlie, and we pray that you would give him healing. Confirm his suspicion this morning that he's getting better, and that he would be able to get back to work and to school, which is his work, and normal life this week. God, we thank you for our world. Help us to be mindful of everyone that we are gathered with in spirit today, that we aren't just having our own little gathering here, but that we are also representing what other Christians are doing all around the world right now, today, together in unity as we praise your name. God, help us to always remember your word in our prayers and to pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's continue to praise the Lord as we lift up our offerings to him.
Thank you.
Gracious God, through the witness of Christ, you show us the kind of leaders you desire, people of integrity and obedience who live with patience and peace. Today we celebrate the ministry of the laity who serve you with faithful hearts and hands, ready to reach out in your name. May each of us joyfully give of our talents and treasure from the abundance you provide. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who came not to be served, but to serve, and who gave his life for our salvation. Amen.
And I know my reason. this life within me cries, and oh, my Redeemer, my Redeemer lives.
Blessing to have such music. Amen. We read again this morning from Nehemiah, talking about the wall. Several of us that have been to Jerusalem in the last 3 years recognize a lot of the names, and even saw some news, some tragic news this week taking place at one of the gates into Jerusalem. But this is, as Carol read earlier, dedication to the wall of Jerusalem. Reading from Nehemiah, starting at 27, skipping a few. Appreciate the pastor allowing me to skip several names that would be mutilated if they were still in there. So you can follow along and see where we are. Starting at 27. At the dedication of the wall of Jerusalem, the Levites were sought out from where they lived and were brought to Jerusalem to celebrate joyfully the dedication with songs of thanksgiving and with the music of cymbals, harps, and lyres. The singers also were brought together from the region around Jerusalem, from the villages of the Neophytites, from Beth-Bagal in the area of Geba and Azmath, for the singers had built villages for themselves around Jerusalem. When the priests and Levites had purified themselves ceremonially, they purified the people, the gates, and the wall. I had the leaders of Judah go up on top of the wall. I also assigned two large choirs to give thanks. One was to proceed on top of the wall to the right toward the dung gate. Ezra the scribe led the procession. At the fountain gate, they continued directly up the stairs of the city of David on the ascent to the wall and passed above the house of David to the water gate on the east. The second choir proceeded in the opposite direction. I followed them on top of the wall. On top of the wall, together with half the people, past the Tower of the Ovens to the broad wall, over the gate of Ephraim, the Jezana gate, the Fish gate, the Tower of Hananel, and the Tower of the Hundred, as far as the Sheep gate. At the gate of the guard, they stopped. The two choirs gave thanks, then took their places in the house of God. So did I, together with half the officials. And then moving down, and on that day they offered great sacrifices, rejoicing because God had given them great joy. The women and children also rejoiced. The sound of rejoicing in Jerusalem could be heard far away. At that time, men were appointed to be in charge of the storerooms for the contributions, first fruits, and tithes. From the fields around the towns, they were to bring into the storerooms the portions required by the law for the priests and the Levites. For Judah was pleased with the ministering priests and Levites. They performed the service of their God and the service of purification, as did also the singers and gatekeepers, according to the commands of David and his son Solomon. For long ago, in the days of David and Asaph, there had been directors for the singers and for the songs of praising and thanksgiving to God. So in the days of Zerubbabel and of Nehemiah, All Israel contributed the daily portions for the singers and gatekeepers. They also set aside the portion for the other Levites, and the Levites set aside the portion for the descendants of Aaron. God bless the reading of the word.
Thank you, Mark. Hebrew is a difficult language for some of us to pronounce certain words and names. You could actually go online. There's some scholars that have mapped all language families all over the globe, and you can put in what your native language is, and it will tell you all the other languages of the world what would be easiest to most difficult for you to learn. And so you know, Hebrew is in a language family that's pretty far out from English, so it can be very difficult to learn. But thank you, you did great. As we know from last week, Ezra, the priest, actually only read the law of God, and then the Levites helped to explain it. So, Mark, you were our priest this morning, and I guess I'm just a Levite this morning, expanding on the text. It's wonderful to be with you all this morning, and I should have introduced my family that are here, but my sister Nikki is the one that sang for us this morning. Thank you very much. It was wonderful, and we could have put it in place of the sermon, probably. Didn't exactly fit the text, but... and then my mom played for us, and then my stepdad Jay is here, and my brother Alex. It's good to have family. It's good to have family visit us in worship. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be open and pleasing to you today. Amen. To you, I will be faithful. He is an awesome God and fills us with joy. He enables us to be free so that we might pursue him and all that is good and become radiant. Our God has been faithful to us before we were ever faithful to him. Our God has been faithful to us even as we have turned away from him. Our God continues to be faithful to us as he waits for us to turn back to him. God's faithfulness to humanity is truly astounding to you and to me. Astounding. Last week we talked about covenant renewal and went through a covenant renewal process which paralleled that of the people found in Nehemiah chapters 7 through 10. I believe it was very meaningful and powerful for many of us. And if you weren't here, you're welcome to go back and try and participate in it through the video online. However, I did receive some responses after our gathering, which I think I would like to clarify. I heard, "I would have liked more time to reflect on the covenant renewal prayer. I didn't like feeling like I was agreeing to all of that without reviewing it." Okay, I get that. "Oh no, the pastor is pulling me into an agreement with God that I'm not sure I want to make." But here's the thing. If you are a Christian, you have already agreed to this covenant. The covenant we are talking about is between God and his church, Christ and his bride. A covenant is not a negotiated contract where each side negotiates what they will give and what they are to receive. In covenants, God decides the terms. Then God puts himself under obligation with promises. Then man is invited to respond by accepting God's gracious terms, trusting in God's faithfulness to his own promises, and promising in response to remain faithful to God. That's why we call it a covenant renewal process. We remember the covenant God has established with his church through Jesus Christ. We remember and we recommit. If you are not a Christian, then you should not have felt obligated to pray the prayer with us. And it probably seemed foreign, and you probably had a ton of questions. Perhaps you felt like you should engage, but you were uncertain. Uncertain about who God is, uncertain about whether you want a relationship with him. And if that's the case, we can talk after. I also heard the covenant renewal service didn't make sense to me. If we can come just as we are to God, how come we are making all these pledges and commitments? Pastor, are you saying that we should earn our salvation? No, absolutely not. Covenant renewal is for those of us who are already the church. Covenant renewal is for God's people. It's not for those outside. Covenant renewal is not about beginning the process of salvation, but continuing it. Covenant renewal would fit into the area of salvation that we call sanctification. In sanctification, we undergo a transformation of our will so that we might become more like Christ. Salvation is not a moment, by the way. It's a process. Your first commitment to Christ is a moment. Your justification before God may very well be a moment. But salvation is a process, according to Scripture. I have been saved, I'm being saved, and I will be saved. But that's a message for another day. The question, when were you saved, pales in comparison to the real questions. How are you saved? And how can I get me some of that? It is true that you can come to Jesus just as you are, but once you have done so, His will for you in your life is healing and transformation. God will take us as we are, no matter how messed up, but as He frees our will to choose more of Him, more good, we will not remain the same as we were. I would be skeptical of an individual who claims Christianity but bears no evidence over time of transformation. If you believe, all God requires is an expression of faith, that His will for you does not include discipleship, it does not include pursuing holiness, the sinner's prayer, but no transformation of life, this gathering of brothers and sisters is quite honestly not for you. I'm not saying the church is not for you. The Wesleyan Methodist tradition is not for you. You're always welcome, but you would be constantly frustrated. Because covenant renewal is between the people and their God. It is a communal act. It isn't just an individual act between you and God. God saves a people, and He saves them through a process. And the real question before you last Sunday, before you today, before you every day, is do you want to be a part of His saved people? So last week we were declaring, to you I will be faithful. Last week we mimicked the people of the text as they declared their intention to be faithful to the Lord. Here in these passages today, we see them continue in that faithfulness. We see them transform their lives and community in accordance with their declaration. They follow through. We know that throughout Nehemiah we have focused on vision. The connection with vision in these passages is really the wrap-up, the sense of closure. What do you do with the completion of a vision, of a major project? You dedicate the work to the Lord. You worship Him. The end of a God-given vision is God Himself. And so we get into the first passage, and there really are two, actually, in today's two chapters. The first passage goes all throughout chapter 11 and into chapter 12. And it is really a tithing of God's people. We begin with the lists of chapter 11 and chapter 12. Oh no, not more lengthy lists. Within chapter 11, verse 1 through chapter 12, verse 26, it's the text that precedes what Mark read for us this morning. There are two major lists. The first list reconnects the people with the land, and the second list, that of priests and Levites, reconnects the religious leadership with one another. Apparently, they were divided beforehand. What a funny thing, the religious leaders didn't all get along. Reunification. Here we have a fuller picture of God, people, and land in right relationship. A brief glimpse of shalom. What is going on in this section? It's the repopulation of the city of Jerusalem. They rebuilt the walls, but they actually hadn't moved back into the city. Notice the first-person narrative of Nehemiah does not resume until 1225 or 1227, which means that Nehemiah is not present throughout the first section, all of chapter 11 and the beginning of chapter 12. He doesn't speak. He doesn't act. We've no idea where he is. Where is Nehemiah? It doesn't matter. If you look at chapter 11, verses 1 and 2, it's not about Nehemiah. The people themselves take responsibility. The people themselves step up. The people themselves claim ownership. Newly renewed, that's funny to say, newly renewed, freshly renewed, recently renewed, under the law, the people themselves voluntarily began the resettlement of Jerusalem. Why? They pledged not to neglect the house of the Lord. Now we see commitment, integrity, follow-through, promise-keeping. We have a unified response to covenant renewal. If you're going to talk the talk, you ought to walk the walk. And the people do. They put their hands to good work. We could easily, mistakenly, think that the focus is on the people. It is, but it isn't. You see, we are looking back in time, watching these people, their lives, their actions, their interactions, through the text. But a shift of focus happens for us, just as it did for them. As our eyes are on them, we begin to notice that their eyes are on someone else, the Lord. Then, all of a sudden, our eyes are on the Lord as well. It makes me think of the worship song, "I Will Lift My Eyes," by Bebo Norman. Do you know the song? In the chorus it says, "I will lift my eyes to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging wild. I will lift my eyes to the healer of the hurt I hold inside. I will lift my eyes to you." The Christian life should include a lot of eye lifting. Take in God's majesty. Take in his glory. Take in his perfection. Take in his magnitude. Take in his character. Lift your eyes to the creator, sustainer, and redeemer of the world. When we look at the beginning of chapter 11, you might think it's kind of curious that they're doing this thing of casting lots. Right? Casting lots almost seems like chance. And it seems like the repopulation of God's holy city shouldn't be left up to chance. So what is that all about? It isn't irreverent. Don't get the impression that the people are whimsical about the business of repopulation. No, casting of lots in Scripture always reveals a simultaneous denial of the omniscience of man and declaration of the omniscience of God. What does that mean? Casting of lots shows at the end of the day, we humans really have no idea. Except what God wills us to know, we are truly at his mercy. So sometimes we shouldn't even try to influence the outcome of events. And at the same time shows us that we believe in his providence. He is all-knowing. He is all-powerful. He is all-good. We believe in his providence, and we trust him. When the people cast lots, they said, not that we're leaving this up to chance. We believe that God intervenes so much in our life that he will make the outcome of the lots be his will. And then we see a tithing of the population. Order and obedience to Yahweh. And 1 in 10 of the people that built the wall are now moving into Jerusalem. This has an obvious theological overtone. Normally the people tithe. Here the people are tithed. That makes sense. Normally we set aside 1/10 of what God has given and offer it up to him. Here God, the people together with God, they tithe themselves. 1/10 of the population moves into Jerusalem. By the way, a couple little side notes about music. I see cymbals in the text, so maybe we could get drums in here after all. I mean, it's in the Bible, percussion. I also noticed in chapter 11, verse 24, that there's a call and response to worship. It says, actually, in that section, they divided the people into two sections so that they could call and respond back and forth to each other. And I always thought, as a child, that I didn't always like call and response litanies, prayers, call to worships, but there it is, it's biblical. Throughout the Ezra-Nehemiah narrative, we see a progression of sanctity. In Ezra, the altar is reconsecrated, then the temple, and then where we began in Nehemiah at the beginning of chapter 3, the walls are consecrated, and then the land. We see spreading holiness. This was mentioned when the high priest Eliashib consecrated the wall at the beginning of chapter 3, and we see it here now again. There's a reference to a place in chapter 11, verse 25, which also means the land of Hebron. And in 11:30 of Beersheba, the list recalls actually the extent of the kingdom under a particular king named Josiah. And why is that important? Because under Josiah, who was faithful to the Lord, the kingdom grew. The kingdom spread. And so the implication here is that God's holy presence has spread beyond the altar, beyond the temple, beyond the walls of Jerusalem, into the surrounding land. We have a holy people living in a holy city, called to spread holiness throughout the land. And we begin to see what is God's purpose with reform. Reform is pruning for growth. Reform is pruning for growth. Cutting away dead stuff so new life can grow. God doesn't just want us to not choose the bad. He wants us to choose the good. And then we get to the second passage, which is what Mark read for us this morning. Chapter 12, verses 27 to 43. And this is a joyous dedication. This is our focus text. The joy-filled dedication of the walls, the powerful celebration of an entire nation in collective worship. Can you imagine an entire nation in collective worship at one time? That is a lot of people. What would that be like? To have the number of worshipers exceed any physical building in the surrounding vicinity. So many people want to worship God that they don't fit in any building in the area. Like these people, we would have to worship outside, marching in the streets, shouting the name of the Lord for all to hear. Let me ask you a question. How many of you were told as kids to get down off of something? How many of you have told that to your own children or grandchildren? Not on this day. The people are called to march on the walls. March on the walls, dear children. How many of you were told as kids you were being too loud? And how many of you have told that to your own children or grandchildren? Not on this day. The sound of rejoicing could be heard from far away, beyond Jerusalem. No megaphones, microphones, or sound system, only human voices and instruments. Is our worship loud enough to be heard beyond Rockville city limits? Oh no, the pastor's going to turn up the speakers and destroy my hearing. Hold it. That isn't really the kind of loud we're talking about here. This is a loud that comes from exuberance, from joy, from a people singing as one, from a people singing in truth. The kind of worship that changes people. The kind of worship that must be talked about. Passionate worship. But what kind of music? Well, we see that they gathered choirs. They also gathered instruments. And the worship is stereophonic, which means vocal music at the front, instrumental music at the back. Hey, give me some points. I'm not a musician, but I figured that out. They have stereophonic music as they worship the Lord marching around the walls. Let's try to visualize what is going on. So I know we have different types of learners, and Alex has reminded me sometimes it's good to see a picture. So this is a picture of the wall around the city of Jerusalem rebuilt, and it may be hard for you to read, but I'll help narrate what we see. So, if you remember, when Nehemiah arrived at the city of Jerusalem and he inspected the walls, he started, I believe it was at the Valley Gate. So that's the one right up there from the city of David, kind of underneath the word rebuilt, the Valley Gate. And that is actually where the people also start their march. And then two groups of people spread, and they walk around the walls as they sing, as they rejoice, as they proclaim God's name. And the reason all those things are listed there in the text, those places, those locations, is so that you could get that picture in your mind of the wall of Jerusalem that they finished in 52 days. They are now marching on top of it. And they are starting where Nehemiah started his inspection. And they're moving in two different directions and coming around. And when you read where it stops, where each group stops, they're stopping near the temple. At the Tower of the Guard, here over on this side, and then I think at the Water Gate over on this side, and then they're going to the temple. So they're starting at a far point and moving around the whole city and then ending up at the temple. So I want to introduce a new thing next week. We're going to divide into two groups. So one of us is going to start on the far north side of Rockville. The other is going to start on the far south side of Rockville. And then we're going to march here singing before we start our worship on Sunday morning. You all good with that?
Amen.
That's what's going on. And did you know today that we're celebrating Hanukkah? We are. Really. Hanukkah is actually what is going on in this text. Because the word Hanukkah in Hebrew is a dedication as a celebration. The people are dedicating the walls. They are Hanak, the walls. It's Hanukkah. In their Hanukkah, we see something we did not see at the earlier celebration before the covenant renewal. We see joy without weeping. There was this mixed emotional response at the completion of the walls. Remember when Ezra was reading the law and the Levites were teaching and they had this big festival. People were crying, but they were rejoicing. It was a confusing time because they were so great and awed by what God had done, and yet they were also standing in the face of their own faithlessness. But now they've renewed their covenant, and there's joy without weeping. We see a structure in the text as they march around the walls. At the beginning and at the end, there's preparations for joyous dedication, and then two companies appointed to march, and then one goes right on the wall, one goes left on the wall, and then two companies meet and stand at the house of the God, and then there's a performance of joyous dedication. There is this sort of symmetrical ordering. There is a purpose to the order of worship. There is a purpose to the liturgy. And the purpose is to impress upon the people the significance of their achievement in means of liturgy. The things that we do in worship have intention. And we see two types of leadership. You see Ezra and Nehemiah, administrative and teaching, division of roles. But here they are absorbed into the community. Because when the community is functioning faithfully, we don't need any hierarchy. And both reformers, Ezra in teaching, Nehemiah in administration, were necessary for the renewal of the people. But really, the people were necessary for the renewal of the people. because a great leader with an uncommitted people is worthless. So remember that the people themselves are the focus of the book of Nehemiah. And if you look at verse 38 of chapter 12, Nehemiah followed, he didn't even lead, the processional. In the upside-down kingdom, leaders must first be followers. So they dedicate the wall, which is not consecrate, which is what happened in chapter 3. And they don't set apart it and make it holy, consecrate. They dedicate it, which means to offer it to the Lord, but also to initiate it for service. So a dedication actually isn't the end of something. It's the end of preparation for something. A dedication or initiation, just like we might have with a child dedication, a dedication or initiation is the beginning of something. We're reaching the end of the book of Nehemiah, and yet it's only the beginning. And we see there's no difference in Scripture between thanksgiving and praise. We see in verse 43 offerings given. And in verse 44, I don't know if you caught this, but we actually see a finance team. There were people that were appointed to take care of the offerings of God's people. And then in verse 47, we see a second offering. Offerings not just to please God, but also offerings to care for the leaders of the community. And really to move the people from a culture of scarcity to a culture of abundance. These are a people that have lived under multiple empires, who have been without a king, who have been without a kingdom, who have been persecuted, killed, and driven into hiding, who have very little. And the little they have, their fields, their farms, they've set aside to rebuild the wall. The little they have, they may have also lost in this project. Which means it should be almost easy to see a culture of scarcity among God's people. But instead, what we see is a culture of abundance. And that's what God does. God, we actually have more than enough. We have so much. You have given us so much. We're going to offer some back to you. And we're going to offer some to participate in your mission of changing the world. And we see spreading holiness again in verse 30. It continues to grow. And what this teaches us about worship is that we are to worship joyfully in holiness. You see that purification in verse 30. With movement, worship should be experiential. And again, we have all the people with unity. Verse 43, with loud exuberance, in response to something God has done, and with order. So what? How does this change my life? God, to you, I will be faithful. Nehemiah teaches us, and by Nehemiah I mean the book, not the individual. Really, the faithful people of the Ezra-Nehemiah period teach us about covenant faithfulness. Covenant renewal is the beginning of covenant faithfulness. So we must celebrate what God has done. Let us celebrate what God has done in our lives. Maybe you've had a change of heart in the last year. Maybe you've experienced healing in the last year, or you know someone who's experienced healing in the last year. More than one type of healing. Celebrate. And let us celebrate with you. We must celebrate what God has done in our church. We exceeded a goal this week for the rummage sale that we can use for mission. We can use to impact the kingdom. We should celebrate what the missions team and the trustees were able to raise this week to take care of our facilities and continue to do ministry. And to not just do ministry to ourselves, right? But to be a people with a mission in service to the world. We should celebrate what's happening at Celebrate Recovery. People turning their lives around, getting out of addiction. We should celebrate what's happening with Kids for Christ. We've got 70 forms turned in. We could have 70 kids this next week. We don't know what to do with 70 kids. But someone came to me, well, several people have come and said, we were prepared for 40. But someone came to me and said, we prayed for this last year. And I said, okay, well, you go talk to everybody else that's not sure what we're going to do with 70 kids. Because you made this happen, you and God. Kids that aren't here on Sunday morning and are probably not in church any other time in their year. Perhaps we're planting or watering a seed. We should celebrate those people that are coming to the class that I've had that want to become members of our church or want to confirm their baptism and become an adult in the eyes of our church and stand with us in unity. We should celebrate what our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit has done for us through the saving work of Jesus Christ. God sent His Son to be here among us. This is really unique. No other world religion teaches this. That God actually cares about His people. And so much that when we fail repeatedly for millennia, He would do something about it. That He Himself would come and be among us, live among us, see our perspective, live, work, suffer, and die like us. To have the consequences of sin and death, even though He was without sin, doesn't exist in any other world religion. To have a God that would go that far, and even farther, when Jesus is resurrected and then ascends to heaven, He sends His Holy Spirit. Because Jesus is the great high priest, He's the great prophet, He's the great king, He's the mediator, and we no longer need that sacrificial system because the Holy Spirit can be with us as we gather. And that grace, abundant grace, is available to us daily. We must celebrate what our God has done. We must celebrate what Christ has done. And let us take it to the ends of the earth. To you I will be faithful. Celebrate in your life. Give Him praise. Worship. Confess Him with your mouth and with your hands. Seek His will. Be faithful in response to His faithfulness. Let's celebrate what Christ has done and take it to the ends of the earth. In your bulletin, you have a 2-page insert that I wrote this week. I hope that this is helpful to you as we're wrapping up our vision series and we're wrapping up our series on Nehemiah. And maybe after today you're asking the question, how do I continue to live in covenant faithfulness with God? We've got 14 days of reflections here on vision and on Nehemiah. And I would encourage you to make this a part of your personal prayer and devotion time over the next 2 weeks. And struggle with these questions. How do you help, or how do you ask God what His vision is for your life? And how do you submit yourself to God's vision for your life? Hopefully these reflections can help you. So, the opportunity or challenge, if you will, is to take what we've done together in worship and apply it in your own life. Just like the people here in Nehemiah did after they went through a covenant renewal process. They walked in covenant faithfulness. They didn't just go through a time of confession and prayer and worship and then go home, back to their normal life. They were changed. As a people, they were changed, and their life showed it. So let's celebrate what Christ has done and take it to the ends of the earth. Friends, we have a story to tell the nations. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Friends, it was so good to worship with you this morning. My prayer for you is that you would be able to continue to live in covenant faithfulness with our God, as He has enabled us to do. We believe that in our church. We believe that He frees our will after we commit our lives to Him, so that we could choose Him and choose good, and that it could continually become easier to do so. And so my prayer for all of us is that we would be able to do that. That we would make that part of our daily life, of committing ourselves, recommitting ourselves back to God. And to walk in the kind of light and love that He has shown us in the example of His Son, Jesus Christ. So hear the benediction, the word from the Lord. This is the sending out into the world. Worship doesn't stop here. The gathering begins our week. Actually, it's what we believe. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you now and forever as you join with Him in His mission to transform the world. Amen. Go in God's peace.
Tired and bring your shame.